gotten them anywhere. They have tried theology and it hasn't worked. But they haven't tried Jesus. They blame all those problems on the way they were raised and their parents. They try to push it off on drugs and alcohol and the way they were, so that they're not accountable for any of their actions. But yet, they're held captive because they think there's no way God can forgive them from what they've done. I've just been too bad. I've just done too much. I've heard people say that to me. I've just done too much, and I've been just too bad. There's no way God would ever forgive me. They're chained. They're chained. They feel trapped. There's nothing out that God would offer me. I have nothing to give him, and I have been so bad he wouldn't take me even if he wanted to. But he does. See, then you come in, you say, listen, brothers and sisters, guess what? This is where I was. This is what I was doing when I found Christ. And if he can love me through it, if he can forgive me through it, then he can forgive you too. Now come out and be separate and give your heart to the Lord. Start serving him and making him your Savior. Delivering the captives of sin. Changing lives. You are witnesses. You are God's ambassadors here on this earth. What are you doing with it? You have the power. You have the knowledge of the Word, as we were talking about. You know what God has done. All you have to do is tell them what he's done. These are just instances that we're going through. Recovering sight to the blind. Without Jesus Christ, you are spiritually dead and your eyes are dull. You cannot see. You cannot see Christ working in your life. You can't even see God. So here we go. We get a hold of a sinner, and they do things to us, and we think, man, they're sinning against God. They don't know that they're sinning against God. They can't see it. I used this reference before, but if you had a blind man over at your house, and had a glass of milk on the coffee table, and went to get up and hit the table and knock the milk over, would you get mad at it? Man, you just spilled all that milk on wine. People talk about wine on carpet. You know, it's got all that wine on this brand new carpet, man. Get mad at him? Well, no. Because he couldn't see it. He's blind. He didn't see it. Not familiar with your house, don't know where everything is, and things like accidents are going to happen like that. You can't get mad at him. So why do we get mad at a blind sinner that can't see what he's doing in our lives? What kind of evil or what kind of schemes and things that he's trying to do to disrupt our lives or put a hindrance or a stumbling block with our walk with God? Can't get mad at them, guys. You got to forgive them. You got to say, Lord, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Because they're blind. And it's only through the Holy Ghost, through the revelation knowledge of the Holy Ghost, that they're lost and undone. That they're dead to God, that they're dead spiritually. And the only way that they can be made alive is through the saving grace of Jesus Christ. The only way that those scales can come off of their eyes and they can begin to see is by the revelation knowledge through the Holy Ghost that has already been revealed to you, and you are witnessing that to them. See? You may think, well, why would God use me? Why would God choose this way for me, for the gospel to be spread this way through you and I? I mean, he's God. He could do it any way he wanted to, right? Because so that you would understand what he did. Because that's how it was from him to the disciples, to the next one he saved, through the saving grace of God. That's how it was revealed through him, because he wanted their hearts drawn to him. He didn't want them to come because they necessarily had to, but because they wanted to. And because, let's see, when you start telling somebody...
All right, guys, thank you so much for listening today, and my time is up, but we'll pick this message up next week, so be sure and listen, and God bless each and every one of you.
We're listening to AM 760 KMTL Radio, Sherwood, Little Rock, North Little Rock, Arkansas, United States of America. This is Inspiration Radio with religious programming at its finest. Southern gospel, Christian country music, and the very best selection of religious programs.
Just to get on board, all you need is faith to hear the diesels humming. Don't need no ticket, you just thank the Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
Greetings in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. This is another day that the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. Hello, and how are you today? I want to welcome you to the broadcast entitled Thus Saith the Spirit, and I'm your host, Vern Jimerson. Call a neighbor and call a friend and tell them that the broadcast is on the air. We certainly are happy indeed that you tuned in to us wherever you're listening to us, whether it's here or whether you're listening to us abroad. We bid you a very warm greeting in the name of the Lord Savior Jesus Christ. Also, we'd like to welcome those that are the new listeners that are listening, those down around Sheridan, Arkansas, and the Grapevine area. Amen. We also want to welcome you to the broadcast this afternoon. Praise God. It's indeed a blessing to be able to come to you by way of radio. Amen. To spread the gospel of Jesus Christ, the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Amen. We're living in a time where we desperately need good news. Amen. Just like most every time you look at the news or listen to the radio, praise God, is something catastrophic or something that's very unpleasant going on. But praise God, the gospel of Jesus Christ is the good news. Amen. I'm happy to be a part, amen, of spreading the gospel of Jesus Christ. Amen. And by the way, this broadcast is coming live from the studios here at KMTL 760 AM, Sherwood, North Little Rock, Arkansas, United States of America. Amen. So we invite you to go along with us as we go into the study of the Word of God. Amen. And you can contact me at Vern Jimerson Ministries at P.O. Box 171 down in Carthage, Arkansas. And the zip code is 71725. And you can also contact me by way of phone at area code 870-403-2447. And my email address is vernjimersonministries@gmail.com. Now then, let's go directly into our message for today. In our teaching today, I want to share a word with you that I believe will enlighten and strengthen you. And I'm pretty sure most would agree it's needed. Amen. We need an encouraging word from the Lord. We need a word from the Lord. Amen. I'm going to go over what's necessary to be an overcomer, to be victorious. And I know it works because the Word of God bears record that Jesus Christ is the example of overcoming the world. In fact, in St. John chapter 16 and verse 33, he said, "These things have I spoken unto you that you might have peace. In the world you shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer, for I have overcome the world." So Jesus Christ indeed was our example. The scriptures tell us that the Word was made flesh and born of a virgin and was told by an angel of God that he is the Son of God and that he shall save his people from their sins. Amen. Praise God. And this was a wonderful a thing that, praise God, that was announced. A supernatural miracle on the highest order. Amen. Now, what I want to do is reiterate the fact that this was the Word of God, made flesh, the incarnation of our Lord in human form, just like you and I. Amen. Just like you and I. Jesus Christ, amen, was flesh and blood, just like you and I. When Jesus came to earth, he was and is the Son of God. He also was like God, but made himself of no reputation and took upon him the form of a servant and was made in the likeness of men. Amen. So he was just like you and I. Amen. And being found, verse 8, and being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. Amen. I really want to make clear how that Christ was a man just like you and I. Amen. Praise God. He was the divine Son of God, but he also was flesh and blood. Amen. He was a man just like you and I. Now, I'm going to go back to what I said about Jesus being the Son of God, but he also being a man. He also was a man. I want to point out that Jesus didn't begin his ministry or mission until God had anointed, filled, and baptized him with the Holy Ghost. Amen. So then, that's the emphasis that I want to stress. The scriptures tell us that God anointed Jesus when John baptized him in the river Jordan. This is when it took place. Amen. Let's go to the gospel according to St. Matthew chapter 3 and verses 13 through 17. Verse 13 says, "Then cometh Jesus from Galilee to Jordan, unto John to be baptized of him." Verse 14. "But John forbade him, saying, I have need to be baptized of thee, and comest thou to me?" Verse 15. "And Jesus answering said unto him, Suffer it to be so now, for thus it becometh us to fulfill all things, all righteousness. And he suffered him." Amen. As I said, John was reluctant to baptize him. But praise God, Jesus said, suffer it to be so, but because it behooves us to fulfill all righteousness. And then he suffered him. Verse 16, "And Jesus, when he was baptized, went up straightway out of the water, and lo, the heavens were opened unto him, and saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and lighting upon him." Hallelujah. This was the anointing, the filling, the baptizing of the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah to God. Amen. I'm trying to show an example here. Amen. Praise God. That Jesus Christ, the Son of God, amen, was baptized, needed to be baptized. And what do you think about you and I? Amen. "And lo, a voice from heaven came saying, This is my beloved Son, in whom I well pleased." Hallelujah. The voice from heaven was the Lord God, his Father, setting his approval on his dear Son. Amen. When he came straightway out of the water, God the Father spoke and said, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I well pleased." Hallelujah to God. The title of the message today is Being Filled with the Spirit. Be filled with the Spirit. Amen. Be filled with the Spirit. John was reluctant to baptize Jesus at first, but Jesus told him, John, that it was necessary. Then he baptized him, and God anointed him and filled him. Amen. Praise God. Can you imagine how John possibly felt? Praise God, when he was baptizing in the river Jordan, the scribes and Pharisees came to his baptism, and he said to them, "Repent ye, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." And then Jesus came, and Jesus said, "I have need to be baptized of you." Amen. And John said, "No, I need to be baptized of you." But Jesus said, "Suffer it to be so." Amen. So then John felt, praise God, just too small to baptize the Son of God. But Jesus said, suffer it to be so. Amen. And when John baptized Jesus in the river Jordan, The Bible says that, praise God, the Spirit sat upon Jesus Christ in the form of a dove, and it remained on him, praise God. So this was the Holy Ghost, the baptism of the Holy Ghost, amen, God being anointing Jesus with the baptism of the Holy Ghost, amen, the Son of God, amen. This was giving us an example. Jesus needed to be baptized and filled with the Holy Ghost. Now, what does that say about you and I? Listen, as Jesus explains why God anointed him. Let's go to the Gospel according to St. Luke chapter 4 and verses 18 and 19. This is what he said. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted. He has to preach deliverance to the captives and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty them that are bruised. This is why, praise God, he was anointed, or why he needed the anointing to carry out the mission, to fulfill his mission on earth. He had to be anointed with the power of God. Amen. Because I said before, he was just an ordinary man until God anointed him with the power of the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah to God. Amen. So I'm saying to you this afternoon, if you expect to do a work for the Lord, if you expect to do a mission for the Lord, to go out and to win the lost, you need the power of God in your life. Amen. Amen. And the times and a day like we're living in today, amen, really, it's urgent and necessary that we be about our Father's business. There is absolutely no time for foolishness. Amen. The stuff that have no significance and make no difference, praise God. Amen. Time is rapidly approaching the second coming of Jesus Christ. And Jesus said the great tribulation days, perilous times, of what we're facing. They're just right around the corner, as it were. Amen. We're already experiencing the beginning of sorrow. Amen. And I'm going to tell you, and I don't want to preach fear, but praise God, this is just the beginning. Amen, praise God. But I want to let you know beyond the shadow of a doubt, you need to be ready, amen, to for Jesus Christ to come. You need to prepare yourself and be ready, beyond the shadow of a doubt, for the second coming of Jesus Christ. Amen. Verse 19 says, to preach the acceptable year of the Lord. Amen. Now this is, praise God, what the God has anointed Jesus Christ to do, all these things. Friend, if you expect to do a work for the Lord, it's absolutely necessary to be filled with God's Spirit. Hallelujah. I know I got that right. Jesus Christ is our perfect example, who did no sin, neither was there guile found in his mouth, and he was filled with the Spirit. Let's look again at the Gospel according to St. Luke chapter 3 and verse 1. It tells us that Jesus was filled with the Holy Ghost, filled with the Holy Spirit, ever how. They're both the same. Verse 1 says, amen. And Jesus, being full of the Holy Ghost, returned from Jordan, and was led by the Spirit into the wilderness. Amen. As I said, the subject of the lesson, of the message today, be filled with the Spirit. Be filled with the Spirit. Amen. What is the significance of being filled with the Holy Ghost? Amen. Well, there are several advantages to being filled with the Spirit. The first is, it is the precious gift of God, of whom Jesus called the other comforter. Amen. He called it the other comforter, the Holy Ghost, and it is and was given to lead and to guide men into all truth. And you know the Holy Spirit has the same name as Jesus. Jesus said that I am the way, the truth, and the life. Guess what? The comforter, the Holy Spirit, is called the Spirit of Truth. Hallelujah. They are similar. Hallelujah. Amen. The same as Jesus did. Amen. In fact, the Holy Spirit is standing in Christ's stead. Did you know that? Praise God. When he went back to his Father. The Holy Ghost is in Christ's stead today. Amen. When Jesus had finished his work on earth, and as he prepared to return to his Father, he told his disciples that he wouldn't leave them comfortless, and that he would send them another comforter, that he may abide with you forever. So then, another blessing about the Holy Spirit is he's going to abide with you forever. But another thing to remember, that is, the Holy Spirit will not dwell in an unclean temple. Amen. We are encouraged to be filled with the Holy Spirit. Amen. And the importance of being filled is when a vessel is full, nothing else can be put in it. Amen. And did you know also that your body, our bodies, is the temple for the Holy Ghost? So it shouldn't be strange that Jesus said, be filled with the Spirit, be filled with the Holy Ghost. Amen. Because our bodies, your body and my body is the temple of the Holy Ghost. Amen. It's made for the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. As I said, praise God, the reason why we are to be filled, amen, when you fill a vessel and you fill that vessel completely full, there's nothing else that can be put in it. Amen. Praise God. In fact, I can't recall Jesus ever saying to fill anything half full.